in a spectacular new movie.
I became sort of obsessed with her.
This legend had a real life more remarkable than the myths. Such was her power and status when she died, her beauty was mummified to preserve her for eternity. The true story of Evita on an all-new biography. Coming up next, only on A&E. Celebrate history with original. From A&E, this is Biography. For December 20th, 1996, Biography with Jack Perkins.
Eva Perón, the legendary First Lady of Argentina, rose from poverty to become one of the most powerful women of the 20th century. Many in America first came to know about Eva Perón through the 1978 Broadway musical Evita.
You were supposed to have been immortal.
Evita won 7 Tonys, music by Andrew Lloyd Webber, lyrics by Tim Rice.
An awful lot of people at the time said it won't be successful because, well, no one's heard of Eva Perón, which is true. But looking back on it now, it strikes me as an amazingly good idea, and I'm amazed we thought of it.
Film director and producer Alan Parker liked the idea too, so much so that he spent 15 years researching Evita's life and making it into a movie for Hollywood Pictures. The movie opens Christmas Day in New York and Los Angeles, starring Antonio Banderas, Jonathan Pryce, and Madonna, a woman whose own blonde ambition made her a star.
I think we have some things in common. I went to New York when I was 17. She went to Buenos Aires when she was 15. I think she was incredibly courageous. I mean, to have started where she started, but then go to where she arrived at was amazing and required an awful lot of courage, and I can definitely relate to a lot of things that she had to go through.
It would seem like perfect casting. One icon playing another.
The more I found out about her, the more I wanted to do it, and the more I was sure I could do it, and I became sort of obsessed with her and sort of figuring out, because everybody I talked to was either completely against her or completely for her, and I just thought, okay, where's the truth in all of this?
The movie now has sparked a new wave of interest in Evita and her astonishing story. But beyond all the Hollywood hype, there's the real story, which we'll hear tonight as Biography presents Evita, the woman behind the myth. Eva Perón, a South American Cinderella, rose from poverty to become one of the most powerful women of the 20th century. Beloved by so many Argentinians that when she died, as a bizarre kind of tribute, they embalmed her body so it would last forever. Who was this woman called Evita, and how did she become a legend in her own time? It's a story that begins in Argentina, a country occupying almost the whole southern part of the South American continent. Just west of the capital of Buenos Aires is a vast expanse of rolling plains known as the Pampas. It was here in a small dirt-poor town called La Union that Eva Maria Duarte was born on May 7th, 1919. A skinny girl with big brown eyes, little Eva, or Evita as she was called, was the youngest of 5 children. Her mother, Juana Ibarguren, was the longtime mistress of a married man, a local landowner named Juan Duarte. Duarte and Juana had 5 children together out of wedlock. Though all of them, including Eva, took his last name, everyone in that small town knew they were illegitimate. This would always be a great source of shame to Eva, who resolved early on to escape her dreary life in the Pampas. Eva attended school up until the 6th grade, but she was never interested in academics. Her dream was to become a famous actress.
She loved movies. It's not different from girls from a zillion small towns that end up in Hollywood. Well, Buenos Aires was the place where you needed to go if you wanted to become a movie star in Argentina.
Evita's chance came in 1934 when a handsome tango singer named Agustin Magaldi came to town on a singing tour. The story that's told is that Magaldi seduced 15-year-old Evita, who ran away with him to Buenos Aires. though some people had wondered who really seduced whom, the tango singer was just the first of many men Evita would use to get ahead in the world. Once she got to the capital, she went through a series of lovers who supported her during her first months away from home. This is why critics later called Evita a whore, for she used these men to advance her career. It was through one of these lovers that she first got work as a magazine model.
Evita was among 12 young women who were sent to my photography studio. She had a swimsuit that she had borrowed. We had to staple it in the back to make it fit. She was very thin, so we stuffed some padding into the top of her swimsuit so that she would look better. I noticed she had very long legs and beautiful skin.
That beautiful skin helped Evita get a lot of modeling jobs. And gradually, she cultivated a more glamorous look. But her career didn't really take off until she changed her looks dramatically by bleaching her black hair blonde. Not long after that, she landed a job on one of the radio soap operas, which were all the rage in Argentina. And Eva, who had a nice voice and looked good in publicity photos, soon became a well-known radio personality. Her star status got her invited to parties and benefits where she met some high-ranking military officers, whom she continued to date and discard until she met a tall, strikingly handsome army colonel named Juan Domingo Perón. Perón was a rising star on the Argentine political scene. An expert swordsman and marksman, he had risen quickly through the ranks of the Argentine army. At 48, he was already Secretary of Labor, and the talk around town was that he might one day be President of Argentina. He had been married before, but his first wife died of cancer. So that when Eva met him at a benefit for earthquake victims in 1944, Perón was a very eligible bachelor.
He was a very handsome man. Hair, you know, full back and lots of teeth. And an incredible mouth full of teeth that smiled every time. And surrounded by generals and admirals, all very old and very stiff. He was the youngest of all the colonels. And he was dashing. So I think that they fell in love.
At 24, Eva had finally found a man with enough power to satisfy her driving ambition. And as the news spread that she was Perón's mistress, the radio station where she worked doubled her pay, and finally she began to get work as a movie actress. The Circus Cavalcade was one of Eva's first films. She played a young country girl who was the rival of an older woman, the movie's big star, Libertad Lamarque. The two women did not get along, on screen or off.
There was indeed rivalry between Eva Duarte and me. I was at that time already a famous actress, so Eva could not compare with me. She would have loved to be a great actress. To tell you the truth, she wanted to be like me, but she didn't have what it takes.
Yes, it is.
By all accounts, Eva was not a good actress, but that didn't stop her from behaving like a prima donna. She often arrived late, making everyone wait around for her. Lamarque finally got so fed up, she decided to confront her rival. She burst into her dressing room unannounced and found Evita having a private lunch with the directors and producers.
Everyone stood up and said, "Libertad, come over, join us for lunch." Even Eva said, "Come on, join us." But I replied, "No, thank you. I am going to join the people of my own class." And I left and slammed the door hard behind me.
Eva never forgot that insult, just as she never forgot the slights she suffered as an illegitimate child, or the rejections she endured as an aspiring actress. But for now, she would file all the hurt and humiliation away. She would deal with it later. For at 24, Eva Maria Duarte was already well on her way to becoming more than just a movie star. Our biography of Evita will continue here on A&E. News on biography. Juan Perón, the dashing army colonel, and Eva Duarte, his glamorous blonde mistress, were a perfect match. Both were smart, good-looking, and tremendously ambitious. Eva moved in with Perón practically the day they met, and they lived together very happily for a year and a half until October 1945, when his career took an unexpected turn. At the time, Perón was Secretary of State, though it was rumored that he was the real power in the Argentine government. Perón was both a popular figure in the military and as Secretary of Labor, he had gained a reputation as a friend of the working class. The young colonel was so popular, in fact, that the current Argentine president decided Perón had to go. On the morning of October 6, 1945, he was arrested and hauled off to this secluded prison on the island of Martin Garcia, off the mainland. No one, not even Perón's mistress, Eva Duarte, knew his whereabouts.
Eva was really afraid because when Perón was arrested, she didn't know where he had been taken. She had heard there was a plan to assassinate him. So when he was taken away, she may have thought that it was to kill him.
When Perón's supporters, the workers and union leaders, heard of his arrest, they organized a mass protest. And on October 17th, angry mobs stormed the Capitol demanding his return. The government had no choice but to release Perón, who was hailed as a hero. He thanked the workers, los descamisados, or the shirtless ones, as he called them, who came to his rescue. It was later said that Eva had organized that historic rally, but that's just an example of the kind of myth-making that surrounds her life.
The idea that Evita organized the October 17 demonstration is not true, because at that time she had not met the union leaders. She did not have a telephone and she was not acquainted with people from the unions. The Peronists created this myth, a white lie, to enhance her image.
But even if she didn't organize the protest, Evita had stuck by Perón when he was down, and in return, he did something unheard of, something that defied every social standard. He married his former mistress in a secret civil ceremony. At the time, men of Perón's rank and social class did not marry their mistresses. So for Eva Duarte, whose own mother never married, it was a dream come true.
Perón, by marrying her, legitimized her. It was the first time in her life that she was legitimate, and Eva felt that that legitimization was an act of genuine love on the part of Perón. This marked the beginning and growth of a very powerful relationship.
Eva was at her husband's side as he campaigned for president in 1946. Riding high on the momentum of the workers' rally, he won the election by a landslide. And on June 4th, 1946, Juan Perón became the 29th president of Argentina. On first taking office, he continued building support among the working classes. He nationalized the British-owned railroads and utilities. And he raised wages so that workers were enjoying the highest standard of living they had ever known. But as he courted the masses, Perón was also turning Argentina into a totalitarian police state. The new president had always been a great admirer of Mussolini, and like his idol, he set up a regime that squashed any and all opposition.
The atmosphere that existed in the country during the Peronismo was of fear.
There was a general climate of fear because they would harass anyone who didn't think like Perón. As a university student, one had to take classes in subjects that were supportive of the regime. Any public official who said anything against Perón would be fired. Politicians who had different ideas were put in jail.
As this new fascist regime took control, thousands of Argentinians were forced to flee the country. Most left for political reasons, but others were driven out by Eva Perón. For as Evita got her first taste of power, she began to take revenge on people from her past, including anyone who had dared insult her
like her old rival, actress Libertad Lamarque.
Some actors and actresses, including me, were on a blacklist. Suffice it to say that no one could talk to me or have any contact with me or invite me to their homes. They punished people who had contact with me. So people turned away from me.
Like many others, Lamarque chose to leave the country as Evita took an increasingly active role in running the state. She commandeered an office in the Labor Ministry where each day she interviewed hundreds of people who came to her to request favors, contracts, or jobs. In a country where women had always kept a low profile, Evita's grandstanding rankled some of the men in power.
The fact that a woman would be involved in politics and would have power and authority over men was inconceivable. The common men and women could not believe this because we Argentinians are very macho. Our Latin heritage is nurtured by machismo. So it was offensive to our machismo that a woman had power not only over women, but also over men.
Evita didn't care if her behavior shocked people. She got up in front of crowds of people and announced, "I am one of you. I know what it is to go hungry." And they responded.
Eva seduced the crowds, and this seduction was good for the Peronist movement. Perón gave her a platform for power and allowed her to say whatever she wanted to say, and he discovered this had a great impact on the people.
Before everyone's eyes, Eva Perón was reinventing herself, changing from mistress to president's wife.
She was the person who invented her own myth, and she was very good at it. Because she's an actress. She's a radio actress, she's a movie actress. She knows about stage, about performing, about being something else than what you really are.
Eva was enjoying her new role as First Lady of Argentina. Suddenly, she had the power to do things she had only dreamed of. For instance, among the Argentine elite, an annual trip to Europe had always been considered a must. So Eva decided she would go to Europe. And befitting her new status, she mapped out a grand three-month goodwill tour. June 6, 1947, Evita's plane touched down in Spain. Seen here disembarking with the First Lady is Lillian Guardo, her best friend and constant companion throughout the trip.
We were looking forward to a nice reception, but it completely surpassed our expectations. Franco and his wife were at the airport to greet her, along with diplomats and all the important people. It was wonderful how she was received.
Franco, who was eager to improve trade relations with Argentina, treated Evita like visiting royalty. He awarded her the Grand Cross of Isabella the Catholic, Spain's highest decoration, and declared a general holiday so that the city's workers could welcome her to Madrid. Through it all, Evita managed to remain perfectly cool and poised, as though she had spent her life as a public figure. But she was really not as confident as she appeared, as Mrs. Guardo discovered that first night in Spain when she was awakened late in the evening by a call from the First Lady.
All of a sudden, the phone rang, and I heard Evita saying, "Liliancita." That's what she called me when she wanted something special. She asked me to come to her bedroom and told me she was scared. So I stayed with her and slept in an armchair the whole night. It wasn't very comfortable. The next day, it was the same story.
Eva Perón, seemingly so fearless, was afraid to sleep alone at night. It was a shocking revelation, but then the First Lady was always unpredictable.
Muy suave, muy cariñosa en un momento.
At times, she was soft and kind, affectionate and understanding. But other times, when people didn't respond the way she expected, she was very harsh with them. That's why I think she was a mix of a tiger and a dove.
In the 2.5 weeks Evita spent in Spain, she attended dozens of banquets and receptions. Her hosts showered her with gifts, including a collection of expensive gowns and jewels. After getting the full star treatment in Spain, Italy came as a bit of a letdown. At her audience with Pope Pius XII, Evita, a devout Catholic, had high hopes he would honor her with a papal title. But this former mistress got a cool reception from the Vatican. She was greeted with great formality, but her visit lasted only 20 minutes, and she left without a title. Paris was no better. At all the receptions, Evita smiled for the cameras, but the strain of having her every move monitored by the press was beginning to show. Unlike the Argentine press, the international news services could print what they wanted. In the United States, Time magazine ran a cover story about the Perones that dared to mention the fact that the First Lady was an illegitimate child. An outraged Perón banned the magazine from Argentina for 4 months. The final insult came when the British royalty refused to invite Evita to Buckingham Palace. It was a blatant snub. And with that, she cut her trip short and headed home. But if her grand tour did not go exactly as planned, her homecoming made up for it. Hundreds of thousands of Argentinians gathered in the port of Buenos Aires to welcome their First Lady home. It was a proud moment for Evita. This poor little girl from the Pampas had come a long way. At the age of 28, she was not only world famous, she was the most powerful woman in Latin America. Our biography of Evita will continue here on A&E. From the moment Eva Perón became First Lady of Argentina, she was very conscious of her image. And like an actress playing a role, she selected her wardrobe with tremendous care, buying dozens of expensive Christian Dior gowns and Ferragamo shoes. By 1948, she owned more than 100 furs, and her jewel collection was said to rival that of Cleopatra. While critics blasted her for being so extravagant, Evita knew that dressing up was a way of saying to the people, "I was once like you, but look at me now. You too can be like me." But no matter how expensively she dressed, to Argentina's elite, Evita would always be a social pariah. The Ladies of Beneficence, a charitable organization run by some of the wealthiest women in Argentina, had a tradition of asking the First Lady to be their honorary president. But they refused to extend that honor to Evita, a woman who, in their view, had slept her way to power. Evita took her revenge by cutting off the society's federal funding. Henceforth, she announced, that money would go to a new charity called the Eva Perón Foundation. From the start, Eva personally directed the foundation's work. Each day, hundreds of people lined up outside her office at the Ministry of Labor, waiting to tell their hard luck stories. She would listen and decide whether they needed a visit to a doctor, food, clothes, or money.
She was always very affectionate toward all the people that came to see her. It didn't matter if they were sick or they had open wounds. She hugged them anyway with a lot of affection and showed them her love. People who surrounded her, who took care of her, used to tell her she should not hug those people, but she would not hear any of it. She would hug them anyway.
The Eva Perón Foundation also built hospitals, schools, and old age homes. Evita City, a huge housing project for the poor, was built in 1948. Today, Evita City is home to people like Maria Elena Warner, whose family was living in a slum before the housing project came along.
We were very poor. My mother had 5 children. And she was a widow who worked in a paint factory.
The Warner family was given one of the 4,000 furnished homes in the new project.
We had everything in those rooms. Beds, tables, clothes for us in the closets, everything. My mother was so happy. Then Evita showed up with a bundle of money. We were next to her,
a first lady. We felt small beside her. She was everything to us.
By 1949, it was estimated that Ava's foundation was distributing more than $50 million a year to the needy. No one really knows the exact figure, since the first lady never kept any financial records. Critics say there are no records because Evita didn't want people to know she was running a huge extortion racket. To fund her foundation, she required every Argentine worker to contribute one day's pay each year. Private businesses were also expected to make large contributions. Everyone knew that to refuse was to risk having the Perones send in government inspectors who would shut down your business. Meanwhile, Evita continued building schools and orphanages, making sure all her good deeds were duly recorded. The former actress had found a new role to add to that of First Lady. She was the Lady of Hope, the patron saint of the poor, and the people adored her.
My mother didn't even have money to send us to school until Eva came. After Eva, we could go to school. And we got shoes. Before, we went around barefoot. When she came, she brought glory and happiness to my house. That's why we love her so much. There is only one Evita.
There was not much her opponents could do. How could they convince people that this angelic blonde, so revered as a saint, was a crook?
Those who received help thought it came from an angel. They saw this woman covered with jewelry, with those complicated hairdos that became so famous, and they didn't think of where those funds came from. How could they not love her, worship her, since she solved their problems? When you get help, you don't ask questions.
As time went on, Ava became almost fanatical about her foundation work, putting in longer and longer hours at her office. Juan didn't seem to mind, for he too was a workaholic. On a typical day, they got up at 5:30 in the morning, had breakfast together, and then worked until late in the evening. But though their busy schedule may have kept them apart, friends say they were devoted to each other.
They had affection for each other, even love. He was more spontaneous and demonstrative than Evita. She was not so demonstrative, but there was love between them, naturally, mixed with work, which was always the most important thing for them.
Juan and Evita never had children. It is believed that Juan was sterile, since he and his first wife had tried to have children and failed. It's unclear how Evita felt about not having children. Her friends say she never discussed the subject. But since raising a family was out of the question, Evita focused her time and energy on her foundation work and other political projects. In 1947, she helped get Congress to pass a bill granting Argentine women the right to vote. And shortly afterwards, she organized the Peronista Feminist Party to make sure that when it came time for women to exercise that right, they would vote for her husband.
If she hadn't been married to him, she would be nobody. She would be an actress, but she would not be Evita. So therefore, anything that she did to take care of him. And by taking care of him, she was taking care of herself.
No one was better than Evita at whipping a crowd into a frenzy of loyalty and devotion. Perón is everything, she'd say. He is the soul, the nerve, and the hope of the Argentine people. Anyone else would have sounded ridiculous, but as his wife, she could get away with saying such things.
She was a fanatic. Today, we would say she was a fundamentalist. As a woman, her passion was working for the cause. You know, when you put together being a woman, being a fanatic, and wanting to serve a cause, you have an explosion the size of an atomic bomb. That was Evita Perón.
Our biography of Evita will continue here on AM.
Between an actress and a politician, between a country and a legend. Madonna, Antonio Banderas, Jonathan Pryce, in an Alan Parker film. Don't cry for me, Argentina. Evita, rated PG, starts Christmas Day in select cities.
Continues on Biography. By 1950, after 4 years of Juan and Eva Perón's extravagant spending and mismanagement, the booming Argentine economy began to falter. As rising inflation wiped out all the economic gains the workers had made, they took to the streets, staging mass demonstrations and threatening a nationwide strike. Tensions continued to escalate as Perón imposed martial law and brought in the military to enforce his will. Anyone who opposed him was exiled or thrown in prison.
I was jailed for 4 months and tortured for supporting a railway strike. I was indicted by the law regarding crimes against state security that rendered people practically defenseless and imposed very tough penalties.
Perón also took control of the Argentine press. If a newspaper dared criticize his administration, he would send in state inspectors who would close it down for failing to meet safety codes. He used these kinds of methods to shut down La Prensa, the country's most famous independent paper. As Perón's strong-arm tactics destroyed the last vestiges of his reputation as a man of the people, his wife's hold on the affections of the poor became all the more critical. By 1950, some thought it might be the only thing keeping Perón in power.
She says that she plays a unique political role. She is the bridge of love between the people and Perón. She is what binds the masses, the descamisados, with the leader. And she knows that there's no one else who can play that role.
Juan would need his wife's support more than ever in 1951 as he ran for re-election. And she was, as always, eager to help, but this time she asked him for something in return. Evita wanted to be vice president of Argentina. August 22nd, 1951, at a rally of more than a million people, Perón, standing above the crowd on a balcony, announced he would run for re-election. But as prearranged, Eva's supporters kept calling her name until finally she arrived and joined him on the balcony. The crowd urged her to accept the nomination for vice president, but she appeared to hesitate. Not until the shouting had reached a frenzy did she finally give in, saying, "I will do what the people say." It was vintage Evita. She played this scene like a pro, making it look as though she was bowing to the will of the people. And it all might have worked if the Argentine military had not intervened. From the beginning, Perón's fellow officers had never approved of a woman taking such an active role in the country's political affairs. And now, if she was elected vice president and something happened to Juan, she would be their commander-in-chief. In no uncertain terms, the generals told Perón if Evita did not renounce her campaign, there would be a revolution. Perón had no choice but to tell Evita to step down. 9 days later, in a national radio broadcast, she declined the nomination she had worked so hard for and wanted so much. "I am not resigning my work," she said, "just the honors." Evita would never get another chance at the vice presidency. Afterwards, people debated whether Perón had done everything he could on her behalf.
I don't know to what extent Perón's Machiavellian mind wanted Evita to be vice president. I don't know if he didn't take advantage of this resentment within the military in order to prevent Evita from overshadowing him. While Evita was doing foundation work, giving out gifts like a fairy godmother, everything was okay. But to share the government with her was somehow to share the power. And I don't think Perón liked this.
I don't think that he was jealous, but he was torn. He was torn between what he saw she was doing for him and what, in a way, he owed to her and what his political instinct and his military training told him.
It was a tremendous disappointment for Evita, and it came at a difficult time, for in recent months she had not been feeling well. She had very little energy, and she was losing weight fast. She put off seeing a doctor as long as possible, but finally a number of specialists examined her and concluded that Evita had uterine cancer.
And that was very sad, because I think that she believed she was immortal. She believed she could do everything. And that invasion of her body by cancer was a very devastating thing. I don't think she had the strength to fight it.
Though he tried to keep up appearances, Juan Perón was also shaken up. It was the same disease that had killed his first wife. And by the time Evita was diagnosed, there was nothing the doctors could do. The cancer had already taken hold and was spreading through her body. But by now, Evita was either so loyal or such a rabid fanatic, she refused to rest. Exhausted and obviously ill, she was still determined to help her husband win his campaign for re-election. Perón had to physically support his wife as she spoke from the balcony of the State House. "If I leave shreds of my life on the wayside," she told the audience, "I know that you will gather them up in my name and carry them like a flag to victory." On election day, Evita was too sick to go to the polls, so she cast her ballot from a hospital bed. But when Perón won, nothing could keep her from attending his inauguration. She looked pathetically small in her fur coat as she rode through the streets in the open car on the way to the State House. Evita was only 32, but her once photogenic face was painfully thin and her smile was strained. This was the last time Evita would appear in public. In the days following the inauguration, her health declined rapidly. One of her friends remembers being shocked by the sight of the First Lady in her sick bed.
Ya no era esa muchacha joven, radiante de vida, llena de fuerza.
She was no longer a young woman, full of life, full of strength, with those glittering eyes, with that natural beauty of hers, with that white and smooth skin. She looked at me. She let two tears go down her cheeks. She was very worried. She was worried about what would happen to Juan Perón.
Our biography of Evita will continue here on A-News on Biography. July 26, 1952, at 9:42 in the evening, all Argentine radio stations interrupted their programs for this special bulletin. The Subsecretariat of Information fulfills the very sad duty of announcing that Señora Eva Perón, the spiritual chief of the nation, has passed away. Eva Perón, the First Lady of Argentina, was dead at the age of 33. To millions of Argentines, Evita had come to represent a hope for the future, a promise of a better life, and they mourned her now with deep and heartfelt grief. This woman who had been born in poverty got the kind of honors normally accorded a president. When it was announced that her body was at the Ministry of Labor, that building was heaped with flowers. By the end of the day, there was not one flower left in the shops of Buenos Aires. One of the greatest crowds in Argentina's history fought to pay last respects to Evita. It was a mob scene that first day. 8 people died and more than 100 were injured in the crush to file past her coffin. The lines that finally formed stretched literally for miles.
The whole population was in mourning. They were out in the streets, and I was there too. During 3 days, we stood online to see her. It was cold and it rained. There were people who would get to where the coffin was and pass out. Everything was very sad. Evita's death was the worst loss suffered by the people.
It was unbelievable. You had to be there to see how much those people were suffering. She had done so much for everyone. They were there wondering what would become of them, who would help them. They were left without hope.
Juan Perón was devastated. He had lost his beloved wife as well as his political partner. And there was concern that without her by his side,
His days as president were coming to a close. A grim-faced Perón walked behind the gun carriage carrying Evita's coffin in a final procession through the streets of Buenos Aires as the Argentine Air Force flew overhead. When she was alive, Evita said her greatest fear was to be forgotten. She begged her husband not to let that happen, and he came up with a bizarre solution. He decided to preserve her body forever, just as the Russians had preserved Lenin's corpse. Perón planned to build a huge mausoleum 3 times higher than the Statue of Liberty, where he would place Evita on display.
Perón felt that if Evita's body was embalmed and exhibited to the public, that image of eternity could also perpetuate a certain image of eternity for Peronism itself.
Perón hired a Spanish pathologist named Dr. Pedro Ara, who had perfected a technique for preserving human flesh. Dr. Ara, a meticulous craftsman, spent 2 years preserving Evita's entire body, including her brain and other internal organs, which embalmers normally remove. By 1955, Ara had completed his masterpiece. But before Perón could build the mausoleum to house his wife's body, his administration came under attack.
The days of dictator Juan Perón are numbered as riot succeeds riot in Buenos Aires and the entire nation seethes with unrest.
Without Evita to charm the masses, they rose up against Perón. As a new military regime took control, Perón was forced to flee the country to Spain, leaving Evita's corpse behind. When the new military leaders took over, they were faced with a dilemma. What should they do with Evita's body, this great symbol of Peronism?
They wanted to bury her properly. The problem was where to bury her, since wherever they put her would become a shrine, a kind of sacred place for all those who loved her.
To prevent Evita's body from being used to rally opposition, they arranged to hide it in a small cemetery in Italy. As the people of Argentina wondered what had happened to Evita, she lay buried under this simple headstone engraved with a false name. She would remain there for 14 years, until 1971, when Juan Perón came back into favor in Argentina. As a gesture of reconciliation, the Argentine government decided to return Evita's body to the exiled dictator. Colonel Civera went to Milan to oversee excavation of the grave.
When the corpse was removed from the ground, the gravedigger shouted, "Miracle! Miracle!" They could not believe the woman was dead.
These photos, never before seen in the United States, show the condition of Evita's body nearly 20 years after her death. Incredibly, she looks just as she did the day she died. The man in the photo is a mortician who is examining the body for signs of damage. But Dr. Ara's work had stood the test of time. After all those years, buried in Milan, the body emerged almost entirely intact. When the colonel delivered it to Perón, he seemed pleased to be reunited with Evita.
I looked at him, and he was crying. So I asked him if he was that moved to see her again. He said that with her, he had been happier than people knew.
In 1972, Perón returned to Argentina to run one last time for president. By now, he had remarried, and his third wife, Isabel, a former nightclub dancer, ran for vice president. Throughout the campaign, Perón never missed a chance to invoke the image of his dead wife. He won his election, and ironically enough, Isabel won the office Evita had been denied. But Juan Perón's last presidency was short-lived. He died of a heart attack just 9 months after taking office. Isabel took over for a short time, and it was on her insistence that Evita's body was finally returned to her family in Argentina. On October 22, 1976, Eva was laid to rest in the Duarte family tomb in the famous Recoleta Cemetery in Buenos Aires.
It's said in Argentina that you could be from the best family, but if you weren't buried in La Recoleta, you were nobody. Evita, a child of poverty, had finally made it. But many people say that instead of burying her among those who shunned her all her life, she should be with the poor people who still consider her their patron saint. For though the Vatican vetoed a plea to officially declare Evita a Catholic martyr, masses are still held today in honor of La Dama de la Esperanza, the Lady of Hope.
She was a saint for me. I don't know for other people, but for me she was a saint. I hang her picture so that God will guide her and keep her in peace.
She is the symbol of the eternal fight, the fight of the poor and the disinherited who want more justice and dignity in their lives. And people don't forget this.
Evita didn't die in the eyes of her people. She is still alive because she left a huge message full of love. She became a myth. Today, Evita is a myth.
Don't cry for me, Argentina. The truth is I never left you. All through my wild days, my mad existence, I kept my promise, don't keep your distance.
On her deathbed in 1952, Evita urged her husband to see that she was never forgotten. Well, after starring on Broadway, now with the film opening next week featuring one of today's biggest stars, Evita can rest assured she is more famous today than ever. Next week on Biography, on Monday, as millions of Christians around the world prepare to celebrate Christmas, Mary of Nazareth, the